Hello and welcome everybody to Spirit Matters. Welcome back after a little break. My name is Dayal and I'm here with the Chuta and Kishore. And we've been separated through time and space over the past week or so. We took a little break, but we're happy to be back. And you're now once again Daily Bhakti Center podcast. How you doing? Love seeing you guys. Kishore, I was just with you. It's weird looking at you at a Zoom screen because we were in person for so long. Now we're back in the Zoom verse. How are you, Achuta? We missed you.
I'm good. You all look like you all look sun toasted, but in a good way.
Sun-kissed.
Yeah, it's like a little bit more than sun kissed, but not sunburnt, but not exactly like tan. It's not like the aggressive tan that people come back and you're like, I get it, fine. It's just like pleasantly, like
Little less than pale.
just.
Beautiful. How was your week?
It was good. It's like without certain things to ground you, I'm now looking back like what was my week like?
I have no idea.
Do I even know? Am I having an existential crisis right this moment?
That's why we're here. Every
Literally.
day, every day, sparking your existential crisis. We had Ram. We had Ram Nomi, Ram's appearance yesterday, and so we were having a lot of leading up to that event. We were doing a lot of storytelling, and so now that's over. So we're back to just checking in how we're doing. How are you, Kishore?
I'm good. I got in late last night and I'm here and here I am. I'm still kind of like in between two places right now, but I feel really good actually. I feel really good, like my heart feels really good. It feels in the right place because I think that doing things online is really powerful and it's really exciting, but I guess sometimes you don't realize how much of an impact something you are doing online is having. Like I remember I was sharing with you both right before Mexico, the statistics, because we were like, is anyone listening to this podcast? Like who's
Oh, yeah,
actually
we looked at the statistics for the
who's
first time ever.
who's actually listening to this?
We're
And we
great.
went
We're grateful
through
for both of you that are listening out there. Thank you.
it. We are grateful for everyone listening. And it was really crazy because it was like people from all over the world and thousands of downloads. And it was just like really crazy to look at the statistics. And you don't really realize how much of an impact something like this is having. And doing stuff in person, like doing we were in Mexico doing a kirtan training for a week. And it's really crazy. It's just crazy in a really great way to see how people are inspired, and it's not something that has stayed with me throughout the training is that it's not necessarily like me, Kishore Chandra, ooh, like this. It's more of like my, I don't know, like our relationship, our constant relationship that we're trying to have with Krishna and how that's somehow or another just like, I don't know, somehow or another, it's just inviting people, inviting people to have that similar relationship. I had a really nice question and I wanted to start us off with this if it's okay.
Questions are great.
I had a question from one of the retreat participants the day after the retreat ended, and she was asking Brudge and I this question, and we had our answers, but I was really interested. I was like, I wonder what Dayal and Achyuta think about this. And a lot of people on this Mexico kirtan training, and it's so inspiring to see, they're like really feeling Krishna in their heart. They're really feeling like bhakti. They're really feeling like, oh, this is something that I could do. And so she asked me, she's someone that's like really, really getting deeper into this stuff. And she asked me the age-old question. She was like, I feel good. I feel happy. I feel excited. I feel inspired. Like I love Krishna and I love everything about bhakti. And like when I chant kirtan, I feel very connected and I feel very like my heart is just opening. And she went through all the positive things, right? And she was like, And I'm in this place where I'm like really thinking, like, is this path for me? Like, what do I want to, like, you know, do bhakti? Is that what I want to do? And her question was, how do I know? How do I know that this is like the right thing for me? Or like, how do I know that this is what I'm supposed to be doing? Like, how do I know that this is the right path for me? And I felt like that was such an interesting question, because I feel like we have that question for so many things in our life, right? Like, how do I know that this is the right job for me? And how do I know that this is the right person for me? And how do I know that this is the right whatever for me? But I think when it comes to like a spiritual practice, it's so much more, the answer is so much more important in a sense. So yeah, I really wanted to share that question with you both and hear from you both. Sydney is saying that you feel at home, which I agree with, but I want to hear from Achyuta and Dayal.
Yeah, I'm gonna lob it over to you first, Dayal.
Oh man, I saw her unmuting. I was like, okay, great, let's hear it, Achyuta, and she's like, I'm giving it back to you. Sydney wrote something really beautiful in the chat. You feel at home. I think that's beautiful. I think that life is so dynamic, and I think that sometimes we try, you know, nothing ever runs on autopilot. And so even when we think, yesterday at the Bhakti Center, we had a beautiful little festival for Ram, and Sadbuj Garanga Prabhu gave a really, really nice class. And in one of the topics that came up in his class was the idea of a guru, or the idea of a teacher. And somebody asked a question like, how do you find that person in your life? And, you know, she was like, do you interview people? Do you, like, how do you go about this? And he gave a really beautiful answer. The first thing that he said was, you know, there are different levels of gurus and teachers. You know, on one level, anybody that teaches you anything is a type of guru or a teacher. You know, sometimes the parents are considered a guru, or your teachers at school are sometimes considered gurus. Like, they teach you anything. And he said somebody who just shows you the path of spirituality is considered a type of guru. And then he said, then there's also sometimes like a formal person that you take some sort of relationship with, a teacher. And he said, but the idea is that the teacher or the guru is meant to bring you closer to higher truth, to spirituality. Like, the goal isn't to find a guru. The goal is, I want to find spiritual life. I want to excel in spiritual life, and therefore I want a guru who can help me to progress in that way. And so I think that sometimes, you know, we're looking for a path. Like, what's my path? What's my path? Like, the path is an avenue to bring you somewhere. And so the goal isn't to find a path. The goal is to find an avenue that brings me to where I feel like I need to go. And where is it that I want to go? Like, destination is so important to have clarity on. And I think that we think that finding the path is like the end point. I found my path. But it's like, finding the path is a beginning point. And no path ever runs on autopilot. And so I think even in Krishna consciousness, even in bhakti, you know, some of us have been practicing a few years. Some of us have been practicing their entire life from the womb. Some of you are looking at my life. It's coming on 20 years now. And I still feel like I'm asking that question. I still feel like I'm asking, like, what's the next step for me? And so I think that sometimes when I feel like the question is, this is my path and I'm making a decision for the rest of my life, it can kind of trip us up a little bit. But I think if we think more of, I'm just going to take the next step that feels right, then I think that we allow ourselves the space to sort of explore things in a little bit more of a human way. And I think that the path is always dynamic. It's always dynamic. And so, but yeah, I love what Cindy says, that you feel at home. One thing that my spiritual teacher told me about, Ranat Swami mentioned about finding a path, is that when you feel like you want to spend more time around a certain group of people than anybody else, that means you've sort of found your path. Is that when you really just enjoy and appreciate and want to spend time with people who are on that path, that's something that's really powerful. And I think it really gets back to, am I feeling more myself, you know? And so I just think it's a very dynamic thing. Those are some thoughts. There's no like a specific answer yet, but maybe that's some food for thought, and I can lob it back to Achyuta, who wants to expand on that a little bit more and share.
I think, you know, the reason I felt like it was important to hear from kind of the both of you was that, like, I feel like there might be an assumption that it's like, well, I've been doing this from birth. Have I ever really had to choose? The answer is absolutely yes. And just like anything else, you never stop choosing. Life is always going to be a series of choices every day, every moment. Nectar of instruction, nectar of devotion, get into the workings of the mind and how the mind is constantly, I like this, I don't like that. Now today, I like this and I don't like that. And the balance is constantly shifting and changing. And it's kind of incumbent on the spirit soul to be aware of those constant shifts and to sometimes be okay with the shifts. Like this, the way the ocean goes, it's like being mad that there are waves in it. So yes, I've definitely had to choose, and I still every day have to choose. I think it's such an interesting question because I like to look at the question itself and kind of like, okay, let's unpack what's really going on here. What are we really asking? Because there's like almost this thing, it's like, well, what, it's like, how do I know this is for me? But also hidden in that is like, what should I be feeling? What does progress look like? What does success look like? What does holding back look like? What do all these things look like? And so, you know, Dale, when you were saying it's important to know the destination, sometimes my sister loves this saying, it's like, you don't know what you don't know. And recently I've been talking to or getting letters from a lot of people, and I'll post something and they'll say, oh, wow, I never knew that. Or I never even realized that. And for me, it'll be something like Krishna conscious, cultural wise, that because I've grown up in it, it's one of those things that I'm like, really? Not everybody knows that, huh? And then I'll look and there'll be someone who's like, you know, kind of initiated within this path, and they've taken these formal vows into this path of bhakti yoga. And then I've kind of like taken a step back and gone, huh. So there were like, to me, they're like these foundational things about Krishna or about culture or about different things. And they're like, wow, I never knew that. And I'm like, and yet you dedicated your life to this path. So that always makes me like ask the question. I'm like, well, what were you dedicating? Like, you know, like, and not in a bad way, but really just informative, like what makes people dedicate themselves to a certain path? For me, I am a lover of details and backstories and stories and getting to really understand. If we have a supreme person, I want to know what that person's like. And so for me, that was a big component of choosing and choosing time and time again, Krishna consciousness, choosing bhakti. And so I'm always kind of intrigued and interested. Well, I'm like, well, what made you choose or stick with this path? Because the philosophy is good, but when you really get deep down into it, the philosophy is not exactly so different from the core essence of spiritual philosophies. So then what was it? And you're right, you know, Radhanath Maharaj is so right in that sometimes it's the people. But then people make or break it, because you put so much in people. What happens if they have a crisis of faith? Now you've got a crisis of faith because that person's not sure if this is okay for them, or if the material world comes in and does what it does, then your faith is now linked to that person's faith. What happens when they have a crisis of faith? And so sometimes I think it's so important for us to kind of look at it like, what is driving me? What is making me choose? And for me at like 18, 19, I really did have to make those tough choices, like really looking at it going, what is it that I'm doing? Why am I doing it? it made me dive deeper into the philosophy to find really hardcore personal aspects that were gonna be like glue that held me into Krishna consciousness. Also, watching Bhakti Tirthaswami pass away was one of the things that solidified my faith in Krishna consciousness. So for me, in some cases, it was about other people. And it also was about making me dig deeper. Why am I here? What exactly is it that I'm doing? And is it all just based on, oh, somebody else said that that was a good idea. Or somebody else said, I'm supposed to feel this at this time. Because what happens if your experience is different? So I know, I think that was like more questions than answers, but.
I think it's beautiful. Thank you for letting us know about your own path and how we all have choices to make, and we continue making those choices. And it's not that once we choose a path, it's like, oh, it's done. I think it was Bhakti Tirthaswami who said we have to recommit to our path every single day. We have to remake that decision every day. And so I think it's really beautiful. Like, how do I know if this path is the right for me? That's the question I ask every single day. It never goes away. It's just a question that we're constantly refining and constantly developing. And I think that sometimes we look at people, I say this as somebody who's on, you know, been practicing or trying to practice for the last 20 years, and with people who are quote unquote new to the path and just discovering and kind of exploring and feeling out, there's a tendency to look at somebody who may be on my side of the whatever and think, okay, they're just solidified. They did it, you know, like, and how do I get there? It's like, we're all choosing every day as we're going. We're all working through our doubts. We're all working through things. And it's just, some of us have had enough experiences to know that build faith. Experiences build faith. Faith is not just a blind decision. Experiences build faith. And so it's like, I've had enough times where it's like I remember, like for me, like I was 18, I was 17, 16. And it was like, I was sincerely, desperately, wholeheartedly seeking God. Like, I was raised in a Catholic family, and so I had this conception, but I was just like, what about people like, you know, this was before Google and before social media, but so I wasn't able to just like look up things and figure it out. But it was just like, okay, I have my own little context of where I'm at. And like, if this is right, what if somebody was just born in Japan or born in Africa or born in Chile? And it's like, how are they, like, they don't even know what I'm doing. Like, they don't even know Catholicism, or like, I don't even know Buddhism, or it's like, how do I know which one is right? So I just was like, what is a universal spiritual path look like? And I was just like trying to figure it out. And I remember at a certain point, my prayer was just like, I've literally done everything I can to figure this out. There's nothing more I'm going to, and I was just like, God, like, you're going to have to show yourself to me. Like, that's just how this is the point in our relationship. Like, I'm just here, I'm ready, I'm waiting, and you're just going to have to show up at some point. And he did. He showed up in the form of somebody that, and I was skeptical. I was just like, what's this person doing, you know? But like, every step I just kept, you know, and I found myself in that space multiple times throughout my life. Like, I'm doing the best I can. I'm doing all the things. Kishore was saying this in our Kirtan training. I'm doing all the things. I'm dressing the way I'm supposed to be. I'm waking up when I'm supposed to wake up. I'm chanting the mantras. I'm saying, I'm doing all the things. I'm reading all the stuff. Why do I feel like I'm still a little lost? It's like, okay, well, let me reassess and recommit my purpose. It's not just a bunch of external things. Walking this path is not just how things look externally. It's internally. And so it's like, we keep asking ourselves that question. I'm having my own little crisis of faith here. I don't even know what I'm doing anymore. I don't know if I should still be here.
I'm really appreciative of both of you, because I feel like when Achyuta finished speaking, she was like, I just gave a bunch of more questions maybe than answers. And I feel like that's really great, actually, because I think we've spoken about this in this podcast. I remember us saying this at some point, but just like being comfortable with kind of being in the gray area, or being in a space where maybe there are more questions than answers. And I was just thinking, because I'm also a very like detailed person, and looking You know, I really appreciated you, Atuta, when you were speaking, because I also, when the person asked me this question, I also was just like, okay, what's really being asked here? Like, what's actually being asked here? And I was thinking that sometimes, like, in general, in life, when we ask these, like, big, almost, like, ultimatum-esque questions, like, I'm really wondering, like, what purpose does that serve? Or, like, why are we asking those, like, gigantic, you know, ginormous questions? Or maybe not why am I asking them, but like, am I really going to get a concrete answer that is going to satisfy me, you know? Because I think we see that in relationships that we have with people, you know, with our parents, with our friends, with our, you know, significant others, what have you, right? And something that I've learned, and I see it from all others and from my own relationships, it's like relationships are constantly changing and evolving and growing, and maybe what it was a year ago or 5 years ago is not what it is now. Maybe it's different in a good way, in a bad, whatever, right? And I think like what you said, Achuta, was so important. It's like I am making the choice to still be here. Like I am making that choice to have this relationship. I am making that choice to continue. I am asking myself those questions, you know, and the answer is I'm choosing to be here with you, you know? And I think that really reflects our relationship with divinity. And that's why relationship, you know, in this spiritual path is so important, because it's like, I am choosing to have this relationship with God. I am choosing to get to know him better. I'm choosing to show up, you know, every time we come to our meditation practice, or we come to the kirtan practice, or we go to the temple, or we go whatever. Because I think it is really dangerous when we base our faith or our like deciding whether this is the right path or not on another person or on an institution. Because then if something goes wrong, like you were saying, Achuta, then our faith gets really shaken. And so the relationship that we have with God is like so personal. It's so personal. And so it's kind of hard to answer that question for someone where it's like, how do I know this is right? And it's like, okay, well, you know, I can't really give you a cookie cutter answer, because it's not a cookie cutter situation. It's very, very, it's very personal. And I think, you know, it's like, how do I, like, I guess like the more and more I live, I guess, like the more and more I have to just like tell myself, like, how can I be okay with not having a definite answer? You know, like, can I be okay with that? Can I do that? And it's like, there are some days where I'm just like, no, I need a definite answer, like from whoever it is that I'm talking to, God or Dayal or Chuta or like whoever, I'm just like, give me the answer. And some days I'm just like, you know what? We just don't know, whatever, like it's fine. And I think like the more and more we are okay with just like being along for the ride, however crazy and amazing and beautiful and sometimes hard it gets, it's like, I'm choosing to stick around for that, you know? And I think that's the hard part. I think that's the scary part. And that's why I think sometimes people are like, but how do I know if it's right for me? But like, how do I know? But how do I know? Because in the rough moments and in the tough moments, it's like, it's almost like we're wanting the answer to secretly be like, maybe I don't know. And that gives me license to skip out or something like that, you know? And it's like, you know, that's the tough part.
That's what, yes. and that's what, like, oh yes, I was like feeling the whole time, I was like, I feel like that question, constantly hidden behind that question is, okay, when is it okay to exit and drop everything and run away screaming? Like, at what point do I have permission where if I'm not feeling secure or whatever, to exit this situation? And we ask it about relationships, we ask it about life, we ask it about everything. And sometimes the answer is, it's like, you can't exit everything in life. You can't. And I think it's kind of significant that we're like entering into, you know, Christian Holy Week. And Jesus, like Jesus is, it, you know, at a certain point, he's like, guys, look, I want you to know, no matter what happens to me, like, you know, knowing full well, you know, Jesus with all of his spiritual precognition, the man is like, I want you to know, no matter what happens to me, this path is going to remain. This path is here. Mm-hmm. And the goal is here. The spirituality is here. And then a whole bunch of stuff happens and everybody freaks out, rightly so. But really, honestly, if we look back to the, he's like, look, I just want you to know, like, I got it. No problems. Follow me and follow. I'm going to show you some awesome things. But no matter what happens to me, this path will always be here. And I thought it was so poignant, you know, Doyle, at some point you're saying, you're like, look, God, you're going to have to show yourself. And I remember I had this kind of turning point. I'm looking at Bhagavad Gita and I'm looking at all of our spiritual texts. And it kind of makes me emotional every time. And I feel like God, on the one hand, is sitting there begging for lifetimes, like, but I've been here. I've been right here. Just saying, just if you open up a little bit, I'll show you amazing things. And we keep doing this thing. It's like, look, if you want me to believe, if you want me, then you're going to have to do the things. And God's like, I've been here the entire time doing all the things. I've been here. And really, we're kind of like running from our own pain and our own attachments and our own fear and our own anxiety. And we keep pushing them on this other person. Like, well, you're going to have to prove it. The burden of proof is on you now, God. And God's like, I've been here the entire time making sunrises and sunsets and aurora borealis happen in New York, which are miracles. And like, he's like, I've been doing the things and just waiting for the relationship to come back with you. Literally, God has been sitting here. We have spiritual preachers and teachers who have been saying God has been waiting with bated breath to reconnect that relationship with us. This is why we have Sambandha as the foundational teaching of our spiritual lives. It's this establishment of relationship. And so then we keep on taking all this fear that's cooked up in our hearts from all our lifetimes of suffering and conditioning. We throw it on the other person. We're like, God, look, if you're supreme, you're going to have to do the things. And he's like, and I'm just saying, if I'm supreme, no problem. Then all you have to do is open up a little.
What you shared was so personal and reminded me of my own situation in life and how I it's like that question that was directed towards you, Kishore, that we're discussing. It's almost like we have to bring that question to our supreme person or to the universe or to divinity. Like, we have to be able to ask that question as well directly and be able to nourish that inner dialogue, because that's ultimately what we're looking for. I'm again, like, a path leads me to a destination. That destination is for divine connection. So I have to be able to have that communication with that source that I'm trying to connect to. And I thought of this verse from Srimad Bhagavatam that I looked up. It's from the 11th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavat Purana. And it kind of a little bit goes back to what Sydney was saying, like, you feel at home. And it's sort of like it describes the symptoms of how we know when we are on the quote-unquote right path, so to speak. He says, devotion, direct experience of the Supreme, and a detachment from other things. These three occur simultaneously for one who has taken shelter of that Supreme, in the same way that pleasure, nourishment, and relief from hunger come simultaneously and increasingly with each bite for a person engaged in eating. And so it's like, you know, when I have a hunger. I have this deep hunger physically, like, just I need to eat. And it's like, how do I know if I'm eating the right food? How do I know if this is right? Well, I feel nourishment. It feels tasty and good. And I'm simultaneously experiencing this relief from hunger. Like, I'm actually decreasing my yearning and need for food. And so in the same way, like, we experience, I'm actually starting to, like, my desire and levels of attachment and detachment are decreasing. Like, the things that I thought I needed so much in my life are becoming a little less important. I'm experiencing this sense of devotion in my heart, this sense of wanting to give back, this sense of feeling a higher connection, and I'm actually experiencing, like, I'm having an experience of spiritual energy in my life, of connection to source. And so we start to look at those things, and it was, we quoted this often. We were in Mexico just now. George Harrison wrote, he sponsored the publication of the Krishna book, and he wrote in the preface, he said, "The proof of the pudding is in the tasting." And so it's very similar to this verse of just paying attention to the changes and transformation I'm experiencing on a personal level. And that change and transformation on a personal level, is an indicator, you know, of whether or not it's worthwhile us moving forward in a particular direction. Irenka said, yes. Sydney said, wow. And those are all in when you were speaking, Achyuta. That's not related to what I said. And Vidya said, Mataji, what you said was so powerful. Humble emoji, prayer emoji, question mark emoji that I can't see on my device.
Oh, I like that humble emoji. Okay, I see you doing it.
beautiful question. Thank you, Kishore. And thank you guys so, so much for opening up and churning it a little bit. It definitely was a question where we got personal in terms of how we answer that question. It wasn't like a theoretical. It was like, this is how I continue to answer this question. We want to see if Kimberly's got some takeaways for us, and then would love to get what we're walking away from before we wrap up today. You got anything for us, Kimberly?
Yes. My takeaway is that the path is always dynamic, and maybe instead of overwhelming myself by solidifying a decision for the rest of my life, I can allow myself the space to explore things in a human way by just taking the next right step and, I guess, asking myself how I feel in return of that.
Beautiful. Thank you, Kimberly. Thank you. Kishore and Achyuta, what's one thing you're walking away with today? What's your walk away?
I'm walking away still with what Achyuta said, is that it's an everyday choice that we have to make. We have to keep choosing our relationship with divinity, and we have to keep asking these questions. Actually, it's a refinement. The more that we continue on this path, we're refining.
Yeah, that's super beautiful, because, you know, the things that might have made us choose years ago might be different now, and we'll see. I mean, that's kind of how we'll start to see growth. I kind of want to take away and sit with, and maybe even start tomorrow, with the verse that you spoke about, Dayal, because I feel like it's so big, and I feel like I really like kind of this as a topic for this week, if possible, just because everybody's asking it, and you shouldn't feel alone. Arjuna's also asking. Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, he's like, well, what does it look like for a person in transcendence? How do they sit? How do they walk? How do they talk? How do they eat? And he really goes in depth. He's like, what are the mechanics of a person in transcendence? And he really asks, like, finite detail, like, down to the, like, how does he goes through it all. And Krishna is so patient. He's like, no problem, I'll tell you, you know?
What color socks do they wear?
Yeah. Yeah. So I really would like to sit with that and really talk about it and see if or how it's shown up in our lives and in everybody else's life here, just to really kind of like churn that sweet rice a little.
I'm just appreciating the sincerity of the question, and I'm appreciating that sincerity, and I'm walking away with more of just a, like, a prayer in my heart that that supreme source divine personality reciprocates with that sincere endeavor in every person's heart, and that God shows up in each person's life in a way that is faith affirming and inviting, and that we feel that, and that we don't all need to necessarily look outside ourselves, but we can ask that question internally and receive an answer. And so that's my petition, that all of these sincere people, all of us, everybody listening, finds that connection internally And they're able to pull down into that well whenever there's doubt, whenever there's insecurity, whenever there's fear, that we can pull down deep into that, into our own experience, into our direct experience, into our devotion and nourishment, and we can use that as fuel to take our next step. And so that's more my, and how I, where am I doing that for myself? Where am I doing that for myself? So that's what I'm taking away. And so glad and grateful to be with all of you guys. Thank you guys so much for being with us, for those listening, for those in our Zoom chat. And we love you guys. And we'll be back again tomorrow. So we really look forward to seeing you. Please take care, be safe, be well, tell somebody that you love them. And we'll talk to you soon. Bye.